Our next guest is here. It's a Health Friday conversation, World Kidney Day. Dr. Jonathan Waller is a nephrologist. This is a kidney specialist and is also a consultant physician. He's our guest. Dr. Eric, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Kenya's biggest conversation.
Thank you very much, Eric.
We call that the hot seat of the Situation Room.
Indeed, I mean it.
Let's get the day's proverb to Father Ali.
Yes. Proverbs for the whole of this week have been from the Republic of the Seychelles. Today's proverb. If a little tree grows in the shadow of a large tree, it will die small.
If a little tree grows in the shadow of a large tree, it will die small.
Mm-hmm. Indeed.
What's your interpretation of this, Dr. Waller?
Well, obviously, trees need sunlight to grow, and they need enough water. The big tree will deprive the small tree of sunshine, and it will deprive the small tree of water. It talks about, maybe I may put it in context about succession. Basically, you can't have a leader who does not plan for his succession. If you continue doing that, then the little trees that should have replaced you will never ever be able to replace you. They'll continue being succumbed, whether it is succession in a family, or succession in an organization, or even in a country.
Wow.
That's my interpretation.
And your legacy will die with you.
Of course.
So to make sure that your legacy lives on, make sure that you push that tree from under your shadow.
Push your tree under you into the sun. I love that.
That's a good one, eh?
Yeah.
It's hard to come from a doctor. I got an A+ in biology.
I mean,
it's water and sunlight and
equals
to
succession plan.
Surely,
I didn't even get to photosynthesis.
No, and
chloroplast.
Wow, it's a
bad. Okay, so
watch out. I'm going to tell you
what's here. Yes. Apple.
Before you know it, yeah. Talk about timber sales.
Bus.
Okay.
Doctor, yesterday was World Kidney Day.
Yes.
Why is it important that the world has a kidney day?
The reason is that the kidneys are like the backroom people working inside your body without you realizing that they are working. You don't even notice when you pee that it's such a wonderful thing that you're passing urine, because there are many people who don't pass urine. And therefore, it is to recognize that the kidneys are important for your health, and you have to protect them. And secondly, to know that there are kidney diseases, and these kidney diseases can present with different manifestations, but often they present with these manifestations too late for you to do anything about it. So the earlier you catch them, the better.
Okay.
Yes.
Let's start with that, what you said, the importance of the kidney. Yeah. What is this? We've all done a bit of, you know, kidogo science, kidogo biology. Yeah, we didn't get our A's. So what is the importance of a kidney? Yeah, but we were in the class.
Yeah, because we understood some concepts.
Yeah, something happened.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the importance of the kidneys are several. The most obvious that everybody knows about is the kidney removes waste products. Basically, when you take in food, the body takes the good parts of the food, and some of those bad parts will not be absorbed in, and therefore it passes through your stool. But some of it gets into you, and then it goes through several processes, gives your body the energy, the vitality, the strength, and a little bit of it comes is left as waste products. These waste products have to come out of the body, and they come out of the body through the urine in that case. That's the first function of the kidney. The second function of the kidney is if you take in water, which is life basically, because 70% or more of you is water. When you take in this water, then the body receives the water it requires, but we end up taking a little bit extra. That extra has to come out of the body. Otherwise, the body's equilibrium will change. So the water also comes out as urine now. So basically, those are the two obvious functions. But there are maybe a couple more that are quite important. The kidney detects the amount of oxygen that is in the blood. And therefore, it's used as a sensor by the body to tell the body that if I'm getting this oxygen, everything is okay.
Mm-hmm.
So if the kidney does not get enough, it does not sense that oxygen, then the kidney fails to tell the body system that the oxygen is enough, and therefore the blood system becomes lower. So the kidney, in an indirect manner, makes you make enough blood so you don't get anemic.
Mm.
And so if somebody gets kidney disease, they get anemia. So that one is not very obvious.
Mm.
And the last, very obvious, is that the kidney makes vitamin D to be quite active. And vitamin D, when it's active, it makes your body absorb calcium better.
Mm.
So if your kidneys are not working well, the vitamin D is not active, and then the calcium gets lower, then you begin getting bone problems as a result of kidney disease. So those are basically, in sum, the four functions of the kidney, four obvious functions of the kidneys.
You did mention the filtering, yeah. Cleaning. Okay, yes. Yeah, you did talk about, because that's interesting, because we tend to hear that, or we tend to know that and stop there. But I think it's interesting, these other things that you've talked about for absorption of certain vitamins, and then...
For sensing,
right?
Creation oxygen levels
of blood.
Basically making blood, yes.
Making blood, all right? So it's a mighty organ, this thing.
Yes.
And I maybe the question I'm going to ask is going to jump forward in the conversation. I think it's okay, but because we can always come back. So because it does these four major functions, then it's we're able to understand that, you know, of course, you know, from some of the things we watch or the things we hear, that by the time your kidney starts to shut down, then essentially you are shutting down. It would be the first, if your kidneys begin to shut down, then it's very easily for the rest of your system to start shutting down. Is that true?
That's quite true.
Huh?
Actually, in for example, patients who are in ICU, I usually tell my colleagues that the kidney is the final frontier. When somebody has been in ICU and been struggling through many different problems with the heart, the blood pressure being low, etc., when you see the kidneys beginning to shut down, then some things are really serious. And therefore, also when there are different diseases and eventually diseases begin causing kidney problems, then things have really gotten serious, because the kidney is quite resilient in withstanding shocks. It's only at the very end that the kidney gets a problem. Yes.
What is it that then would push the kidney to that level of actually starting to receive the shocks? Because like you said, it's really resilient.
Yeah.
It's everything proof.
So it's a progression of events that ultimately make the kidney stop doing what it's doing. And the kidney can stop doing what it's doing when it gets a shock or if it actually dies. When it gets a shock, it's usually something immediate. It's like somebody has fainted by the street. So we all expect that that person who has fainted will wake up eventually.
Yeah.
Once the, whatever has caused it, the shock is passes on. Therefore, this we call acute kidney injury. The things that cause this acute kidney damage are usually lack of blood supply to the kidney. And this can be from a number of reasons, maybe because you're dehydrated, your blood pressure is low, you've used the wrong medicine, etc. Also, it can be because your kidney is trying to produce urine, but the urine is blocked from coming out. So if you have got a prostate problem and the urine is not coming out, you have abnormally formed urinary system, and it doesn't remove the urine correctly. You have got a kidney stones both sides, it's blocking the urine, etc. The third type of short-term shock, by acute in medicine, you mean a short period of time, not the severity. So the third type of short-term shock is if the kidney gets damage from inside the kidney cells. So the filter has gotten damaged, the tubes that are inside the kidney have gotten damaged, etc. The immune system has attacked the kidney, all those things. That one, the kidney goes into shock. If it's a shock, it's severe enough, the kidney fails completely. And then when the disease recovers, then the kidney recovers. The second type of kidney damage is when the kidney basically dies slowly. Actually, this is in form of forming small type of scars in the kidney that ultimately over a period of months to years cause the kidney to completely stop working. This is called chronic kidney disease, chronic meaning long term. This chronic kidney disease can be by a number of variety of causes. The most common is diabetes, followed by high blood pressure, and then there are some immune system problems that attack the kidney unfairly and the kidney gets damaged. And then there are people who have used medicines wrongly for a long period of time, such like causing conditions. When the kidney dies, then just like anybody who is dead, there's nothing you can do to revive them. So that late stage of kidney damage is one that you want to catch up early, when you can do something about it before somebody is declared to be fit to go to the mortuary.
The chronic ones. And you said diabetes, high blood pressure, and it was the third one.
Yes, diabetes, there are a number of them. Diabetes, high blood pressure. You can have immune system attacking the kidney, what you call glomerular problems, etc. Yes.
So how can we avoid that?
As I've said, when the scars have already formed, it's just like, Eric, if you have a scar on your skin, there's no way you can go to a doctor and tell them, I've got this scar here, can you give me medicine to make it normal skin? So in the same way, when the scars have already formed, there is no medicine in current medical practice, current scientific knowledge that can convert a scar to normal, because a scar is you lost some cells and you have replaced with packing tissue, just to replace it to make it look like a shape. So we have to avoid this progression to do as those scars, and there are a number of things that we can do. The first obvious one is to catch it as early as possible. We catch it as early as possible by remembering that the kidney is a filter, and that filter filters blood to be on one side, plus things in the blood called proteins, which are big, they remain on one side, and water comes out with waste products, and that is what we call urine. So if the filter is not working well, then in the urine, we'll find there's blood and there's protein. It's like I come to your house and you serve me tea, and then I find the tea leaves, what we call majani, at the bottom. And you know that kichungi of yours in the kitchen, there's a problem.
Shimo.
You can have shimo. So in the same way now, the kidney has got problems with the filter, and therefore if you do a basic urine test, which any laboratory can do, if you pick up protein and blood in the urine, then it's a sign that maybe there may be a problem in the kidney. The second way is to check your blood pressure. If your blood pressure is elevated, then there's a problem with the blood pressure, with the kidney. There might be a problem with the kidney. The blood sugar is another screening test. If your blood sugar is getting higher, you're at risk of kidney disease. And these are the screening tests that you are doing. Once you pass through the screening test, then you say that you have something that is pointing to a kidney disease. You can do the definitive test of checking for the kidney, which is look at the creatinine, and to look at that is a waste products in the kidney, in the blood, what is called urea, electrolytes, and creatinine.
Okay.
Yes.
From the little biology that I remember, there's the top, that gland on top of the kidney, the adrenal gland. What role does it play in the health of the kidney and the system? And does that now, when we say that there's a renal problem, is it now attached to that gland? So what does it do? And it's right on top of the kidney. How do they correlate?
Adrenal, ad means next to, and suprarenal is another name for it. Supra means above the kidney.
Yeah.
It's a gland that is found above the kidney, and it's a hormonal gland. It produces hormone.
Okay.
So these are just neighbors.
Okay.
One invaded the plot of another one.
They don't have anything to do with each other.
They have an indirect relationship, because the hormones from adrenal gland, they are adrenaline. Adrenergic hormones. Adrenaline, two or three other hormones, and adrenaline can increase pressure and can it directly affect the kidney.
However, we talk about renal problems in relation to the kidney.
Yes.
So what's the connection here?
So renal refers to the functioning of the kidney.
Okay.
The kidney now involves not only the function of the kidney, but also now the for example, if you have got a big prostate and the kidneys are blocked from passing urine. Or in the past, you used to say somebody has got renal failure. The kidney is not doing its work.
Okay.
But this not doing its work is not because of the kidney itself. Mm-hmm. It's because of it's doing its work, but the waste product is not coming out.
So therefore you
lump them together as kidney diseases. Although some kidney diseases are because of the kidney directly, and therefore we call those ones renal diseases.
Okay, there's something you've mentioned that has become quite frequent. That you will find cases of an enlarged prostate, but it's not necessarily cancer.
Yes.
But that it has something to do with an infected kidney. How does that work exactly? And how would you then know that? How would you rule out the cancer and then know that it is an infection of the kidney that is then causing this enlarged prostate?
So the enlarged prostate is found at the bottom part of the men's bladder. It surrounds the urine passage coming from the bladder out. That prostate, somehow from age 40, it begins getting a bit bigger. It gets bigger naturally.
Okay.
It's a gland that produces some secretions that help in ensuring fertility is maintained. When those when the gland becomes bigger, it grows outside, but it also can grow inside.
Mm-hmm.
In those men who are unlucky enough for it to grow inside, it narrows the urine passage, and then you begin getting urinary symptoms. And these symptoms are symptoms of not being able to pass urine well. For example, you find that you have to push harder to pass urine. You find that you wait longer when others have finished passing urine, you're still trying to begin passing the urine.
Mm-hmm.
You find that the urine does not hit the wall nicely, but it falls in between your legs. You find that it comes, starts and stops. When you finish passing urine, you feel like some is still remaining inside.
Mm-hmm.
Those are symptoms of what you call bladder outlet obstruction. In that case, then you do an ultrasound and you see the prostate is big.
Mm-hmm.
If the prostate is big, it could be big because it has grown big by itself this naturally,
mm-hmm.
which you call benign,
mm-hmm.
or it can be big because there's actually a cancerous process going on. Since cancer of the prostate is quite a serious problem and it's a common cancer in men,
mm-hmm.
then we encourage screening for cancer of the prostate. There is a test for blood called prostate-specific antigen that can be used as a screen, although it's a bit controversial because it can be elevated for other reasons and it might end up making the diagnostic process injure more than actually the diagnosis of the disease.
Mm.
So at the moment, we encourage a urologist, which is a kidney specialist, who is a surgeon, to examine the prostate and check if the prostate is hard and how it feels.
Mm-hmm.
Better still, you can do a scan and see how the prostate looks, and then you can also do an MRI. If things are very suspicious, then you can get a sample from the kidney, a biopsy from the kidney.
Okay.
But these are the benign causes.
Mm.
Usually use medications to try and shrink the kidney. If the medications don't work, then you have to do a prostate surgery to remove the prostate.
Okay.
Yes.
Is there a relation between frequent UTIs and kidney problems?
Well,
UTIs being urinary tract infections.
Yeah, urinary tract infections are common in women.
Mm-hmm.
However, if they occur more than once in a year, then you say those are frequent urinary tract infections.
More than once is frequent?
Yes.
Okay.
If they occur very frequently, then we might have to find out what is the cause of them being frequent. If a urinary tract infection occurs in a man also, that is not normal. So men should not get urinary tract infections.
Mm.
If it occurs, it's either there is a problem with what I call plumbing.
Mm.
That means the urine passage is a problem, isn't it? Unfortunately, I call urologists plumbers sometimes. So there's a problem with the plumbing.
I'm sorry, you have to explain the plumbing issue. CT is a bit uncomfortable.
Yeah, so there is a problem with the plumbing system, and therefore you need to, when somebody gets frequent urinary tract infections or the patient is a man, they need to do a scanning of the urinary system and find where the blockage is that is encouraging this urinary symptom.
Oh, wow.
So the infection is because of a blockage?
The infection
in
women usually is not because of blockage. It occurs once in a while. So there are some factors that can lead to it. Most of the time, it's not explainable how a woman is getting a urinary tract infection.
Mm.
They are easy to treat.
Mm.
Easy to diagnose, easy to treat.
Mm.
However, if the infections are occurring frequently, the infection is occurring in a man, it has to be find out what is the reason.
Mm.
Yes.
Yukoshida pipe.
Yukoshida.
Dr. Jonathan Wala is a nephrologist. That's a kidney specialist. He's here because yesterday was World Kidney Day, and it's important for us to have this conversation to understand how the kidney functions, and also just talking about kidney and how to take care of our kidneys so that we don't end up going to the doctor when it's too late. Can we say that if somebody has high blood pressure, maybe they're under medication, are they necessarily getting their kidney affected?
Well,
does high blood pressure go hand in hand with the kidney?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it does. I think the nice word you have used, hand in hand, is quite apt. Because kidney disease causes high blood pressure. And some high blood pressure, especially if it is very high, can cause kidney damage.
Okay.
Therefore, that's why they go hand in hand. Sometimes it's difficult to know which one is the chicken and which one is the egg. One of the functions of the kidney, when you are removing, it's removing water and salts, is by doing that it also maintains the blood pressure, and therefore the kidney is involved in blood pressure control. If the kidney is getting damaged, then the blood pressure begins going up, and everybody with kidney failure almost invariably they get high blood pressure. Therefore, that's why you use high blood pressure to be a clue that maybe we might need to check about the kidneys to ensure that they are okay.
Mm.
If the high blood pressure is the say normal type of high blood pressure, which usually occurs between it begins at the age of onset of around 35 to 50 years, usually does not go very high. The normal blood pressure should be less than 120. The high blood pressure is from 140. So if you have blood pressure of around 170, I'm missing only one figure, so it doesn't cause a lot of confusion in the numbers.
Mm.
If your blood pressure, high blood pressure, the higher figure is more than 170, 180 there.
Mm.
So those are the people who are more likely to be having kidney disease, or they could be getting kidney damage from the high blood pressure.
Mm.
The high blood pressure, if it occurs in somebody with kidney disease, needs to be controlled to avoid the kidneys getting even damaged. And therefore, we say that high blood pressure should be screened as an indicator that somebody needs to be screened for kidney disease.
Okay.
Yes.
So as long as somebody has high blood pressure, and maybe it keeps fluctuating like that, they should regularly have their kidneys checked.
Yes, they should regularly have their kidneys checked.
Mm.
If somebody is less than 30 years of age, or if somebody is beginning to have high blood pressure in their 60s, then there's something wrong. There might be another reason for that high blood pressure. That is not ordinarily when high blood pressure starts. And therefore, this is what we investigate as a secondary cause of high blood pressure. The first category, which is 90% of people with high blood pressure, they have got what you call primary hypertension. The exact reason for the high blood pressure is not known.
Mm-hmm.
The second category is those ones who are falling around this usual curve, and they have got secondary hypertension. One important cause of secondary hypertension is kidney disease. Although there are a number of other reasons why secondary hypertension can occur.
Okay. So now, someone has been diagnosed with a kidney disease.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you do?
So somebody, when they get, thanks a lot, and somebody gets diagnosed with kidney disease, the clue might be because the urine protein or urine blood is evident.
Mm.
The clue may be because the creatinine, which is a test in the blood for waste product, has gone a little bit high.
Mm.
In that case, then you say that you have got kidney disease. If you have got such early causes of kidney disease, we try to establish the cause of the kidney disease. Is it the kidney disease that has occurred because of something recent or something for long term? If it's something long term, is it because of the obvious things like diabetes, high blood pressure, or do you need to get a sample of the kidney and find out what it is? And that's why you need to be referred to a nephrologist who will evaluate you through these things and try to, as specific as possible, get the actual cause of the kidney disease.
Mm.
When the kidney disease has been diagnosed, then the prevention from mild kidney problems to advanced kidney disease is by controlling blood pressure. That's one key. The second is by decreasing the amount of salt in your diet, which is also a measure of controlling high blood pressure. The third would be to decrease the amount of protein that you take in the diet, because protein puts a lot of pressure in the kidney. Not exactly that protein gives more waste products, but it puts a lot of pressure in the kidney, and that pressure makes the kidney get worse.
All protein?
Animal protein okay. Mainly, but even high protein, but it's very difficult to get high protein diet from plant protein based diets only.
Mm.
And then lastly, it is to ensure that you're not getting, if you have diabetes, it is controlled well. Lifestyle changes are important. You've already talked about one lifestyle change, which is a low salt diet. Apart from the low salt diet, just a healthy life, exercise, ensuring that your weight is up. Actually, obesity is a common driver of worsening kidney problems.
Mm.
Lastly, the kidney specialist will prescribe some medicines that have been shown to prevent the progression of kidney failure.
Mm.
If this fails and you still progress to kidney failure, then the option would be to start treatment to replace the kidney function, because the body needs to for the body to be healthy, you need to replace that kidney function. Since you cannot cure a scarred kidney, then the only way is to replace the function by doing dialysis and ultimately doing kidney transplant for those ones who are eligible.
So that was my next question.
Yes.
Because the frequency with which we see some of this is also the frequency which we see dialysis. A lot of people are on dialysis. We cannot see them and know this person is on dialysis.
Mm-hmm.
But we also know that there's a burden on public hospitals today. Private hospitals obviously have that sorted out.
Mm-hmm.
But it's expensive.
Yes.
But before we get to all of that, in terms of its treatment, what is dialysis? What exactly is happening? It just sounds like some supersonic system whereby you're removing everything and putting it back by the end of a session. What's happening during this?
It's actually relatively straightforward.
Okay.
That blood comes from you and passes through a filter, because the kidney is a filter. So the blood goes into a filter, and by pressure and by the laws of physics, some waste products come out from one side, which is highly concentrated, to another side that is lower concentration. And then also you push in water out. Mm-hmm. So you've done the two things that the kidney is supposed to do, removing waste products and removing water. And then now that blood flows back into your body.
So dialysis is basically doing what the kidney would do in the body, but doing it outside of the body.
Doing it outside the body.
Then, so what so confused. So what goes?
Why does it happen throughout?
So yeah.
In between the dialysis sessions,
what's happening?
Who's cleaning your system?
Yeah. That is the reason why dialysis is a bad way of treating kidney failure. So it's a way of treating kidney failure to make people feel better. It does not sort out the problem and does not address these other functions that I mentioned of the kidney, the anemia, the bone control, etc. So basically, blood comes from you, usually through a big vein, goes into the machine, and the machine, by machine, you just mean the a membrane, a filter that has been put, exactly the filter that you use for your cleaning water. Almost the same. So now it passes through the filter, and then now comes out. In the filter, you pass in things, a fluid that will collect waste products and remove that fluid at the end. And that's all that has happened. The blood comes out cleaner. Then you put a little bit of pressure inside the blood, or you put a little bit of negative pressure on the other side where the water is flowing, and then the water gets sucked in. So that means you can remove waste products and you can remove water. Once that has happened, it is happening at a speed of a particular speed over a period of 4 hours, usually. Then once that has happened, you are creatinine, for example, a waste product, it's supposed to be less than 100. You are on dialysis, so it's maybe 800. By the end of the dialysis session, it is 200. Then you leave the dialysis session, and then you continue doing eating, and your body continues metabolism. So the following day, it is 350. The next day, 600. By the third day, it's around 700. Again, you go back to dialysis and do the same thing.
So it's just emptying the trash?
Emptying the trash.
That's exactly what's happening with dialysis.
But what I'm finding strange is when you empty the trash, doesn't it give the kidney reprieve? Or did you just say that once a kidney is sufficiently damaged or scarred, it actually cannot be repaired?
It cannot be repaired. And therefore, giving the kidney does not need this reprieve. The kidney is a cleaning system. So it's not as if you are resting the kidney and therefore it will make it better. The kidney heals if you remove whatever has gotten better before it has caused scars. So by the time the scars are formed, there's nothing you can do. For those ones whose kidneys are fainted, acute kidney injury, then you do dialysis to maintain life until the kidney heals. Usually it can take 2 weeks, even up to 2 months before they heal. Once it heals, urine becomes more, you do the test and find the creatinine, the waste product is coming down by itself, you know, the kidney has healed, there's no need for doing dialysis. But these ones who have got diabetes, the kidney has gotten damaged over a number of months to years, they start dialysis, you know that this process will continue. It's supposed to be 3 times a week, 4-hour sessions. But because of the health insurance system in this country by NHF, it's twice a week done. And therefore, it's also already inferior. Then you have to factor in that you have to give blood boosters because you're not taking care of the anemia side. The medicine that is given is the same medicine that athletes use to dope, because it makes your blood level really go up and you become stronger. So you need this medicine to do that, the erythropoietin, APO. And then the second thing that you may need to check your calcium and phosphorus, the bone salts, to ensure that they are okay. So that's what dialysis does. It sustains life. It prolongs life somehow. But the length of life of somebody in dialysis is severely curtailed.
So the solution here is an overhaul.
And solution is a overhaul.
Right?
Yes.
Remove this kidney, bring another kidney.
Bring another kidney. Not remove this kidney, bring another kidney.
But then
the old kidneys remain.
There.
Oh wait, you, You don't remove the
kidney. No, you don't remove the
kidney. For dialysis?
A transplant.
Yeah. No. This is the thing. For dialysis, what you're essentially doing is to do the work that the kidney would normally do for it and then put everything back.
Mm.
So you go back after dialysis with a clean system.
Yes.
But the unfortunate thing is that the kidney over time cannot do what it's supposed to be doing.
Mm-hmm.
And then your next session means that you come back and clean again.
Now, we have the long-term solution.
The long-term solution would be
overhaul,
which is removing the thing, isn't it?
No. He says you don't remove. You bring another kidney.
And now, but in order to put one kidney, you must remove the one that is spoiled. You have three.
Excuse me.
That's what I'm asking, but you said you bring another one.
So you were
but you must remove one.
Uh-huh. Why?
The kidneys are hidden under the ribs behind here.
Right. Yeah.
But when people are kicking each other, they don't kick the kidneys and damage them.
Mm.
So that's why they're hidden here. Now, because they are hidden, it's very difficult to remove a kidney. It's a lengthy surgery.
Okay.
So when you're doing a kidney transplant, the donor, the person who's giving a kidney, will undergo a lengthy operation to remove that kidney that God has hidden under the ribs.
Mm-hmm.
The person who is receiving will have the kidney put on the lower part of the tummy. Most of the time, the right lower part of the tummy. That's where usually the appendix is there.
Mm.
So actually, it's not inside the cavity where the intestines
are. It's not in the rib cage.
But it's under this. There's a skin, and then there's muscle, and then there's a covering of the intestines. That's a peritoneal cavity. So it is actually under the muscle.
So there's enough space there.
There's enough space. It bulges a little bit, but there's enough space.
Okay.
So you have now the normal kidneys, which are working maybe around 10%, 5%, or even 0%, and then the new kidney. So this new kidney.
I have a question.
Get it now?
I understand. Mm-hmm. However, see, there's plumbing.
Yes.
Because the kidneys, those two tubes
that are bringing urine to the bladder.
What are they called? I remember when this is Mr. Person. Urethra.
Not urethra.
Urethra.
Without an H.
It comes to the urethra.
Yes.
Now, those are attached.
Yes.
From those two, they're attached to one place.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
This third, because essentially what we're trying to do is maintain this system.
Yes.
So when you do a transplant,
what are you doing to the plumbing?
So the plumbing, the original plumbing is remaining.
Mm-hmm.
Then you get the ureter, the tube from the kidney, new kidney.
You graft
and it's put inside the bladder in a different hole.
Now that's plumbing.
Put a tree.
You graft it,
isn't it?
That's plumbing. Now.
That's plumbing.
Mm. And then this blood, this
like a pipe.
Uneka tea.
Yeah. Okay, tea, because now the tea will cause it to go backwards.
But you're inserting it within the ureter.
You did the bladder.
Into the bladder.
Into the bladder directly. Because you'll also use the bladder to act as a valve.
Because you're still going
the urine does not go backwards into the kidney.
Okay. Right. Because the urination function, you still want to maintain it.
And you want to maintain it one direction, not to be going backwards.
Backwards.
Yes.
Okay. Now, this one is very interesting. Now, clearly this has been done.
Mm-hmm.
And the people were living with three kidneys.
Mm.
Okay. Once you get this other kidney that is well and healthy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So now, the boost it gives to your body, does it help the other kidneys function better, or is it left alone to be doing? Because you're saying those two do 10%, is it going to be left alone doing 90%?
Yes, it's going to be left alone doing 90%. Often these other kidneys will not improve in their function because they've done a transplant. Actually, they continue degenerating their function until they don't produce any more urine, and therefore it's 0%. This other kidney is doing 100%. And it does all the functions of the kidneys that the dialysis cannot do. So it also makes blood, it also ensures your blood pressure is well controlled. Actually, most people with kidney failure who are on 3 or 4 or 5 blood pressure medicines after the transplant has been done, most of them, they remain only one or several don't have any blood pressure medicines anymore.
Mm.
So kidney transplant becomes a cure of the high blood pressure, especially for younger people.
Mm.
And then it also ensures that the bones remain healthy. When you compare somebody who has done a kidney transplant and somebody who remains on dialysis, then the transplant is risky the first 3 months because of the procedure of surgery, of a wound, of anesthesia, etc. But once 3 months have passed, the curves basically separate. Transplant adds maybe 15 to 20 years, depending on your age at which you've done the transplant, 15 to 20 years into your life compared to if you had remained in dialysis.
Mm.
So what I tell my dialysis patients is, you are getting into a dialysis room Just look at all the people you know in that dialysis and ask them and find out who has been there the oldest.
Mm.
And you find 5, 6, maybe 8 years.
Dialysis will not go beyond that.
So,
the solution
is transplant.
Yes. Now let's talk about transplant.
Mm.
Yes.
In this country, we know there are very many people who are going through dialysis.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Do we have as many number of people who are going through kidney transplants?
We do not. And that is one of it resonates with the theme of the World Kidney Day yesterday, which was toward advancing equitable access to not only care of the kidneys, but also to medications in terms of kidneys. This equitable access means you have to access the dialysis, first of all, and therefore the access of dialysis has been made better for two main reasons. The first one was that National also Insurance Fund has been covering dialysis for the past 10, 12 years or so. And it has done a wonderful job because we knew people who used to, it used to be a death sentence.
Oh, yeah.
The second is when the quite controversial program of Management Medical Equipment Scheme, they put equipment in different county hospitals. Part of the plan was to have 2 units in each county.
Two dialysis units.
They were successful in ensuring at least 1 unit was there in each country. And this has really provided access to many patients who need dialysis.
Mm.
The challenge comes in that for you to get into dialysis, we need to know how to get blood from you into the dialysis machine. And this requires a catheter, a pipe that is put in a big vein in your neck or even in your leg that brings out blood and puts it back. That catheter, unfortunately, was not being covered for by NHIF. So that's the first challenge. And then the second challenge has been that now exit out of dialysis is difficult because transplant is not covered adequately. The transplantation process is maybe in a private hospitals may cost maybe around 2 million shillings. In public hospitals of Kenyatta National Hospital and Moi Teaching Referral Hospital will cost maybe around 800,000 to 1 million shillings. So NHIF uniformly covers 500,000 or so, maybe 450,000, which is quite a boost for most patients, but it leaves a substantial portion not being covered, which most people cannot raise. More importantly, there is an impediment that you need to do tests to prepare the donor and yourself for that transplant. And those tests might cost maybe between 200 and 250,000, which most people will not be able
just
to afford.
Test.
So now you have somebody who is doing dialysis, they're being paid for by NHIF, they don't remove a single cent.
Yep.
And then suddenly you tell them, if you do, you need to do this. And furthermore, they also can see patients who did Harambee, they did a transplant, then the transplant went on well, now they have got a bill for medicines post-transplant, coming to maybe 30,000, 40,000 a month. Yes. You can see that's a problem.
Why does it cost so much?
Why does the cost for transplant is, first of all, cost for 2 operations. And you said both of them are quite major operations.
Mm.
The 2 operations are done by 2 teams. Therefore, you have got two surgeons.
Simultaneously.
They are happening almost simultaneously. You start with the donor and then go to the recipient. So they have 2 surgeons, etc. There's anesthetists needed. Then there are some medications that are given during the procedure, which are also costly. Mm. And then there's a hospital stay. So this is basically covering most of that.
Mm.
Yes. So it's not, actually, for most surgeons, doing a transplant becomes the true calling. You don't get much from doing a transplant. The amount, the cost of the surgeon is given after a transplant is less than after doing a cesarean section. Yes.
Let me ask the question. In this country, it's a two-pronged question. How many successful transplants have we had?
The first transplant in Kenya was done in 1978 by a team led by late Professor Elias Otieno, and it was successful. They said it was a Turkana boy. I don't know how the follow-up was. Since then, after that, the transplants were quite were not done until a few in the 1980s. One or two transplants in the 2000s. The main part time when transplants picked really picked up was in around 2011. When there was a program by a pharmaceutical company called Novartis together with Kenyatta National Hospital, doctors taken to Spain, refreshed on transplant cause, and then the program started. And that jump-started transplantation in Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
At the moment, we're doing maybe around 50 to 100 transplants in a year.
Wow.
The success rate is quite immense because our program is where you're being given a recipient is being given a kidney by somebody who's alive. It's not a disease program yet.
Mm-hmm.
So this living kidney donation is quite successful. Maybe I can say the end of a year, 95% of kidneys are still working,
okay.
Which is quite a good success. The long-term success maybe might be a little bit lower than international standards because of the medication maintenance of the transplant with medication, because you need lifelong medications.
Why do you need lifelong medications, doctor?
This is a kidney coming from somebody else, and the body's immune system is designed so that, to simplify things, instead of recognizing this is a bacteria that causes pneumonia, this is a virus, this is a fungus, etc. All you need to do is, when you are an immune cell, is you are taught in the womb that please know that this is me.
Anything
else who is not
foreign, we're going to reject it.
They reject it. Mm. So transplant kidneys from other people are lumped together with viruses and bacteria. And therefore, that's what you remove. The medications, therefore, they suppress your immune system so that it doesn't recognize the transplant kidney, but at the same time maintaining a level of recognition of bacteria and viruses so you don't get infections easily.
Okay.
Somebody who's had a kidney transplant, you said this can add up to 25 years of their life.
Yes.
What's the downside?
The downside of a kidney transplant is that these medicines to suppress the immune system, they make you not, your immune cells not be very vigilant in checking for infections, but also more importantly checking for cancers, because cancerous cells are also changed in a way that they are looking foreign, and therefore they are removed. So immune system is always removing cancerous cells. When you get cancer, it's because there's a failure in the checking of that cell. So if you have medicine that suppress your immune system, you're more likely to get cancers. And that's what we do. Mm. We screen for patients after a number of years, every year, to ensure they don't cancers.
Mm.
Then the second downside, we've said, is infections, which can be managed. But sometimes if your immune system is suppressed too much, you may get severe infections, ranging from TB to severe lung infections, etc., which can be life-threatening.
Mm.
These are two most common causes of curtailing of the life of a transplant patient. Okay. The third one is that because of a number of reasons, including the kidney disease and the medications, you end up getting higher chance of getting cardiovascular diseases, strokes, heart attacks, heart failure, etc. And that's another big killer.
Mm. What is the likelihood? I mean, after the test, one would assume that because of the test, that's when you're testing compatibility and all of this.
Mm.
Would the body of the recipient then reject? How would you know if the recipient had rejected
the kidney? If the recipient rejects the kidney, then they go back to kidney failure, and the kidney failure symptoms don't come out immediately, and therefore it takes some time before you can pick up. The same way when a normal person gets kidney failure, their symptoms don't come up immediately. So that's how we screen, in quotes, kidney transplant patients. That means follow-up.
Mm-hmm.
Every time they come to the clinic, I need to have a urine test, and I need to have the creatinine, how it is.
Mm.
If the creatinine goes up a little bit, I begin the process of working out. Is it before something happening because of blood supply? Is it something inside the kidney? Is it a blockage, etc.? And if eventually I may need to get a sample of the kidney, do a kidney biopsy.
So then you've said also, because we're looking at, you know, high blood pressure.
Yes.
Somebody with high blood pressure has high blood pressure. If this person gets a transplant, gets a new kidney, they still have high blood pressure.
They still have high blood
pressure.
Remember the chicken and egg scenario.
Yeah.
So most of this high blood pressure in these patients is because of a kidney disease.
It was caused by kidney.
So now if you do a transplant, you might find that you don't need blood pressure medicine anymore. Maybe you might need maybe only one.
Okay.
Yes, blood pressure gets quite well controlled.
Okay.
So kidney transplant is a very successful way of ensuring not only the length of life of a kidney failure patient is restored almost to normal, but also the quality of life. The things that you can do, they've got young people who have money to go back to high school, money to go back to education, they are basically stagnated.
Mm.
For most patients who get kidney failure, their life stops the time that they have kidney failure.
Imagine. Yeah. Can you be born with ask the question from, you know what I'm
failed
trying to
kidney.
Say. Yeah, or
with kidney problems.
Damaged kidneys, yes. And for most children, it's quite a heart-wrenching thing when a child gets kidney failure.
Mm.
There are so many problems that you had not factored in, that you don't factor in for adults. Children can get kidney failure from congenital abnormalities of the kidneys, the ureter, the bladder. And there are many, and a number of them, of reasons why they occur, and there are a number of different ways they may present. Children can also get kidney failure from severe problems that occurred in the womb or outside, and that will cause kidney damage.
Mm.
Once the kidney failure has occurred, and the child will present with the symptoms that are usually not very straightforward, they are non-specific, so we present with lethargy, with not feeding well, not gaining their milestones, playing well, beginning to not eat well, vomiting, etc. The same symptoms that adults have, the what you call non-specific symptoms that should raise a suspicion that maybe you need to check the kidney function.
Sure.
Yes.
So, what is your clarion called now to Kenyans? World Kidney Day was yesterday.
Yes.
What would you tell us?
The first is that screening for kidney disease is simple. It's done, only that if you don't notice that it's being done.
Mm-hmm.
Many people get urine tests checked and blood tests for kidney function checked. Tell your physician to check your urine, to check for the blood test, and give you the results and tell you what you need to do next.
Okay.
So screening is available, especially for high-risk patients. Mm-hmm. High-risk patients are diabetes, high blood pressure, age more than 60 years.
Okay.
If you have a family history, if somebody in your family has got kidney disease,
mm-hmm.
that would be my first message. The second message is that kidney failure is not a death sentence. There are many dialysis units, and it's available. It sustains life.
Mm-hmm.
Better than that is to do a kidney transplant, and there are many transplant centers. You just need to ask for a nephrologist who can guide you through the process of kidney transplant. The third message is that dialysis is life saving for these patients. At the moment, there is a serious crisis with funding for health hospitals in Kenya. The NHIF is not funding properly the hospitals because they have got many pending bills, basically, and remitted claims.
Mm.
For most hospitals, they can run a little bit on this, but eventually they're going to collapse. For dialysis units, their only revenue source is NHIF. Therefore, you basically cripple it. At the moment, the Rural Private Hospital Association and the Kenya Association of Private Hospitals have already issued a notice that from next week, actually first in this week, for some of them, they are going to pay out of pocket. And we are going to go back to before 2010, when we used to see many people dying because they are not able to access. And this is quite a shame. We are a message from Kenya Renal Association. I'm the president of Kenya Renal Association. Our message is to urge that this matter to be resolved as quickly as possible for the benefit of our children, of our dialysis patients, including children and adults.
Mm.
I think that is the main message that I want to pass.
Dr. Harry, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely brilliant. And thank you. We've learned a lot. Dr. Jonathan Wala is a nephrologist. He's the president of
Kenya Renal Association.
The Kenya Renal Association. He is a consultant physician as well. He's been our guest.
This is The Situation Room. The only way to start your day.